We're not going through the looking glass here, down the rabbit hole, or any other metaphor. We're going to a soggy field in Cumbria. This is real life, where the conspiracy theory movement, born out of COVID, has become a true community, one that is here to stay.
It's like 9/11. That was all a bit, wasn't it? We all know that that was an inside job.
With its own festivals, its own celebrities, where children are taught to chant its slogans.
I do not consent!
We spent days and nights inside and found a carnival of free thinking. There are all sorts of dividing lines in British life, things we don't agree on, political, cultural, ideological. But here, perhaps, is the deepest, when one part of the population rejects the other's version of reality.
How do you convince a population to subdue them? But guess what? It was a psychological operation, a total psyop to take away your independence and freedom.
It's the first May bank holiday and I'm going camping, not necessarily for fun.
We've come here to West Cumbria, just outside the Lake District actually, and we're going to the Weekend Truth Festival, WTF for short. I think most people would describe it as a conspiracy theory festival. They would say they're seeking the truth and that they're awake, but there's actually all sorts of these festivals happening all summer long. This is just the first.
Other events are being held in Sussex, Hertfordshire, Glasgow, Dorset, Surrey, here again in Cumbria, and in Leicestershire. It's taken long and careful negotiation with the organisers, Nick and Kev, to allow me inside this one, and to allow us to film. As you'll see, there is hostility towards the mainstream media among the attendees here. But they finally agreed.
Basically, it's a gathering together of like-minded people who basically think alternatively to mainstream.
We talked about this, how a lot of people came to this, especially through COVID and through lockdowns and vaccines. This feels like a community that has existed beyond that, that there's something a bit more durable. Is that a fair assessment of it?
Yeah, it's a fair assessment. It is more durable. I think COVID has sort of woken people up to other things that go on. And I think naturally we've gravitated towards each other because we're all very similar.
That's the reason I've come here. To understand why a movement born in lockdown not only exists years after it lifted, but appears to be growing. It is a huge community online, with hundreds of thousands of people subscribing to the main Twitter and Telegram accounts. But the people pitching tents here have given £100 to meet their truth heroes in real life, as the festival promises, over 3 days of talks and activities. And understanding why means bedding in properly over the next few days. As the evening draws in, I make friends with our neighbours. Teresa and Andy are both from Stockport. They met and made friends through the conspiracy community. They're warm, genuinely kind, and offer me relentless cups of tea.
I'm certainly not an anti-vaxxer. I've had all my vaccinations throughout my life, my daughter and my grandchildren, but this one was different for me. I didn't think I'd be here 3 years ago in a place that I am, but this journey's been, it's been a great journey for me because I've met such wonderful people.
Teresa is a former civil servant. She was living alone during lockdown. She didn't bubble with anyone else.
It just didn't feel right to me. So then I started doing some, digging and so forth. And I think through social media, I don't know, that I met up with other people. And hence that's why I'm here today. I initially met up with all these people, or a lot of people that are here today, and Rebels on the Roundabout. We do that on a Friday night in Stockport. That's where I met Andy and these lovely people that are here this evening.
We'll need to unpick some of this. Rebels on Roundabouts is a protest group that says COVID was ruthlessly exploited by a global elite through their puppet politicians and the mainstream media, and is part of a sinister control and depopulation agenda. Specific false theories like this one already have a large natural audience. According to YouGov polling, 4% of the British population, more than 2 million people, believe it is definitely true that a single group of people secretly control events and rule the world together.
I recall during the COVID, reading the book The Great Reset by Klaus Schwab. And that scared me. You know, I thought, is that the world that we're aiming for?
The Great Reset is an initiative from the World Economic Forum, or WEF, the organisation founded by Klaus Schwab, a hate figure for this crowd. It is admittedly poorly named, a grandiose, slightly sinister title that was always going to be catnip for conspiracists. And most people here believe the Great Reset is really a plan to impose a worldwide totalitarian government, and it encompasses other restrictions like ultra-low emission zones, ULEZ for short, low-traffic neighbourhoods, LTNs, or the idea of 15-minute cities.
It's quite anodyne though, isn't it? It's sort of a WEF, quite sort of bureaucratic. Like,
our politicians go there. Why is the cabinet full of people who've been through their sort of
training,
management systems and everything?
As we talk, more people join by the fire. All the while, we ourselves are filmed. And they're eager to set me straight.
But there was a lot of harm done due to the lack of debate, because a lot of medical professionals not only lost their jobs, but also lost their licence. Because there was no debate.
Because beyond the theories, whatever you think of them, there is real, deeply felt emotion here.
That's not right. That's not right.
Not least by Teresa herself. Her father had to move into a care home just weeks before lockdown.
It wasn't nice, you know, to go and visit your father and see him behind me. Do the glass. To not be able to give him the loving care that he deserved. You just don't get over that, do you, really? You know, you come to terms with it, but it wasn't nice, and I just think it was unnecessary. And these are the harms that the COVID lockdown did.
For all the journey that she would describe herself as having been on since the death of her father, Teresa still has some limits.
Sometimes I might think something might be a little bit... I mean, even I think sometimes I'm not sure about that.
Like, what sort of thing?
Well, people talk about reptilians and stuff like that, you know.
Reptilians are a bit far.
Yeah, a bit far-fetched for me, you know. But then I can't, you know, who am I to say to somebody what you're saying is utter rubbish? That's their belief.
All right, so, Gillian, what are we doing?
Well, we're going to have a look at this stone circle here on the land, and we're going to restore, refresh and re-energise it.
The next morning, another festival goer leads me to a new frontier, a field behind the main site.
You've got some sticks.
Yeah, these are divining rods.
Teresa may not believe in reptilians, alien lizards controlling the world, as popularised by conspiracy theorist David Icke. But the freedom movement is a broad church, and it includes people like Gillian England, formerly a psychotherapist in the NHS, who takes me to see the ley lines in the morning.
From my point of view, I'm a being of consciousness from a realm beyond planet Earth, and my job is to assist the developing consciousness of humanity, believe it or not. So I believe in the higher galactics. I know for a fact I've got my star family that I connect to, but this is a fifth dimension and beyond.
Where is that?
Well, it's beyond this reality. Yeah.
You might wonder what her New Age vibe has in common with anti-lockdown protests on a roundabout or the Great Reset. What ley lines have to do with ULEZ? But it's crucial, because when COVID prompted people to do their own research, as they say, they found a world ready and waiting to welcome them and draw them further in.
I've been awake all my life to this, but as you say, the COVID era has really woken people up. So, you know, they were stuck at home, got off the rat race for a little while and started questioning.
Down at the festival, Gillian and others gather the children.
I do! Well done. So now you know how to stand in your magical power.
I do not consent was a rallying cry for anti-vaxxers during lockdown. It's now a slogan for the freedom movement, and they're taught it young. This is probably the most troubling part of the festival, the part where legitimate free speech perhaps crosses into something darker.
Speaking to people, it's clear the pandemic was such a big initiator, and all of us were anxious, all of us were worried. Then you had people like Teresa going through huge personal trauma on top of that, lockdowns adding to a sense of power. So I suppose it's no surprise that people wanted to find some meaning, and some people found that meaning in this worldview, in this community here in articles online. And the question is, what happens after that?
Because there is violent rhetoric here, and primary school-aged children have a front row seat. I listen in on several talks and hear that COVID was an attempted genocide, that the military is secretly running the country, that there is a Satanist cult planning something very nefarious, and that I, as an employee of the mainstream media, are part of it.
So they're gaslighting you, that's fraud.
And just as quickly, though, it is all bonhomie. Legendary Southampton footballer Matt Le Tissier receives a hero's applause for the anti-vaccination stance that led to his cancellation.
Can you hear us back there?
Then there's drinks and dancing in the tent. Welcome to the real counterculture. Teresa gives us a wave. Day three. Andy is forced to cook inside his van. The weather has turned. I want to catch up with him and Teresa.
This is our third morning as neighbours, I think.
Yes.
Yeah, it is. How's the festival been for you guys? Have you enjoyed it?
Enjoyed it, despite the weather.
Especially ahead of the day's headliner speaker, Katie Hopkins, the former Apprentice contestant who's been accused of being a far-right commentator.
You know, she said that she hates Islam. She said that gypsies are feral humans. That's a direct quote. You know, it's people have free speech, but something's surely beyond the pale.
Well, I mean, I think I said to you earlier, you know, it's not somebody that I warm to. Yeah. And, you know, her way of presenting things, it's not the way that I would do. And I'm not always comfortable what she says. But going back to the free speech, but then sometimes some of it can be, would appear to be offensive, you know, sometimes even I go, ouch, I'm not sure about that.
Down at the main site, this was an overt call for political action. A party that seeks to replace career politicians starting in Edinburgh. Others have launched an initiative to stand candidates as independents in this general election, saying they are in a war to halt the influence of globalists. But probably the largest challenge to mainstream politics is the crossover between many of the positions here with those at the far right.
So why would they want to take away your independence and freedom? They're planning something very, very nefarious.
Another speaker, who says ULEZ traffic control cameras are bioweapons that will turn us into literal zombies, asks us to interview him. Mark Steele served time in prison back in the 1990s for shooting a teenage girl in the head.
So what does Rishi Sunak do? He's injecting with a biochemical weapon. Everybody's getting sick and he's saying you're not going to get sick anymore. So there's going to be no sickness benefit. They've put me back to a third world country, right? It's where he comes from. These third world countries, right, where there's...
Rishi Sunak doesn't come from a third world country. He's from Southampton, well, Winchester.
Oh, I thought he was an Indian.
No, he's British. He's born...
Oh, he's British. Oh, well, what defines you as British?
Well, he was born in the UK
to be fair, right, I mean, I don't know where he's from, right, but his background, they don't mind having people starving in the street.
He applies a magnet to try and prove that my arm contains an antenna from my COVID vaccinations. If a ULEZ camera activates it, he explains, I could explode. This is the most extreme end. And even with the most open of minds, it is honestly exasperating.
I've now got antenna in.
You've got an antenna in.
So the ULEZ camera could be used to...
kill you.
Okay.
Yeah.
With the pulse.
Yeah.
For others, though, it's illuminating. And it explains how festivals like these push people like Jenny, a former schoolteacher, further up the conspiracy ladder.
What's been the most interesting bit you've heard?
I enjoyed that,
yeah.
But it puts your blood pressure up a bit, doesn't it? I mean, I already knew some of it, but it fills in the gaps. And I think everybody here is making connections, like, based on their own experience.
Yeah. So, like, before that talk, you didn't know about cameras being fusion weapons, and that was...
I didn't know that, no. Yeah. No. And there's a lot of helpful advice.
It's time to go.
I haven't heard anything that sort of qualifies as hate speech. Some of the talks have been pretty harmless, some have been interesting. Some have had a very aggressive, almost violent tone. They accuse their opponents of raping and torturing children, of committing genocide, that politicians have been committing murder, that there's a plan to replace the native white-born population of the UK. And that's the sort of talk that could have real-world consequences, that could perhaps lead to direct action. Those are some of the lines that have got the biggest cheers.
Before I leave, I speak to Nick and Kev, who are delighted with how the festival has gone.
Some of it was really aggressive. I was surprised by that.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think we can't concentrate on that, though, can we? Because, I mean, there has to be a bit of edginess in it, because we're in some difficult conversation and difficult times. I mean, when you approached us about actually coming to speak to us, you did say that you want to test the political climate and how people are feeling about things.
The only thing left to do is watch Katie Hopkins, who doesn't let us film inside the tent. She gets a rock star reception, though, and promptly singles me out in front of the crowd.
Would we have any lefty press here, would you say? Not you, behind you in the corner. I smell a virgin.
Her show is undoubtedly a hit with the audience.
I smell lefty pressy scum.
Teresa did say that she felt sorry for me when Katie Hopkins called me a virgin. But she and Andy enjoyed it otherwise. They head back up to their campsite. They have lives and families outside here. But these are really their people, and this is really their place. As it is for so many. Tom Cheshire, Sky News, West Cumbria.